Hi there, this is your personal CFO here, and I'm back with another video. Now in this video, I'm going to talk about why I am seeing a artificial supply shortage in the housing market. It's relatively well known that there is a supply shortage, and a lot of times you hear news headlines talking about how they need to increase supply to meet the demand. Now I'm going to talk about why there is such a shortage and why the shortage may not be truly as severe as they make it sound. We'll talk about all that in more details. I have a couple really cool graphics to share with you. So first, I have an article here from September 28th from a website called Bankrate. I'm not familiar with them, but I quite like this article. I'm just going to touch on some of the key points here to explain and to set the stage before we get into some of my points. He starts off here, key takeaways. The housing shortage is essentially a problem of supply and demand. There is not enough housing supply to meet the demand of those who want to buy. Talks about the pandemic, inflation, and rising interest rates have all contributed to the shortage. New home construction dropped precipitously after the Great Recession, and it is yet to fully recover. He then goes on to state here, according to the National Association of Realtors, the supply of homes for sale in the U.S., typically measured in terms of months of housing supply, reached a record low of just 1.6 months in January of 2022. A little bit further down this article, he talks about what a typical normal amount of inventory would be. He mentions typically you would want to see maybe 5 to 6 months of housing supply. The number has come up since that 1.6 month number that I provided previously, but as of today, it's only 3.3 months of supply. Now, the author goes on to state here, both buyers and sellers feel the impact of insufficient housing inventory. Many would-be sellers are unable to list their homes because they can't afford the price of a new one at the current mortgage rates. They're not wanting to sell their current property that maybe has been locked in at a fixed low rate of maybe, let's say, 3%, and then go and have to buy a home. They need somewhere to live. They don't want to sell a home at a low rate and go buy at a house that may cost them 2.5 times more per month to satisfy the mortgage payments. As a result, a lot of homeowners who would prefer to downsize or graduate out of a starter home or simply move to a new location are waiting it out. That keeps those homes off the market and out of the inventory pool. That is critical. That'll play into what I am going to talk about in terms of this being an artificial supply shortage. To state here, buyers are likely to bear the brunt of this problem. A lack of housing options creates a very competitive market in which there's often bidding wars, driving up home prices. When you have a lower supply, the demand is so high for those few houses that the prices begin to skyrocket. And we've seen that quite a lot over the last 2-3 years since the pandemic began in 2020. He goes on to talk about how long maybe this shortage will last. The answer is no one really knows, but I have a couple of ways that I think that this market can find equilibrium. I will talk a little bit about that briefly at the end of this video, so stay tuned. Here I have a graph. It shows existing home sales versus the 30-year fixed rate mortgage. The yellow line that you're seeing there is the 30-year fixed rate mortgage. As you can see, that rate climbed immensely since the beginning part of 2022 here, nearly tripling if we continue to see it go at this pace. Now, the problem with that is that it's discouraged buyers, sellers from selling their home to, let's say, upgrade, downgrade, find a new home, move for whatever reason. You're seeing a large drop-off in terms of existing homes being sold and put on the market. The difference is staggering. For example, here you can see in February of 2022, there were 6 million existing homes for sale. Well, you look at, let's say, February of 2023, and that's a relative high point, you only have 4.5 million. So, you know, you've cut that amount down significantly. If we look at today's numbers, the summer of 2023, that number was almost half of what it was back in February of 2022 of 6 million. So a big drop off there. Now, there's a little bit of an argument out there that, oh, well, new home builds will help fill the gap, will help provide the supply that's needed. Well, that may seem possible, but when you look at the scale here, you're looking at millions of homes typically being listed every month of existing homes. If you look at new homes being built, yes, we've seen a run-up since, you know, the beginning part of 2022, but this is only 750,000 homes. So in order to fill the void that's being left by current home buyers or current homeowners not selling their homes, it's a gap of millions upon millions of homes, and that's not going to be filled anytime soon by home builders. Now, I want to talk about what I expect could occur to create an equilibrium in this market. Equilibrium just simply means the demand and supply have begun to level out. So there's just about as much supply as there is demand. You really want that in every single marketplace, because if you don't have it, the market will find it. It will find its own equilibrium. Now, the problem I think we're running into is this is an artificial supply crunch. The rising of interest rates have pretty much discouraged any homeowners from selling. Well, that's not going to change anytime soon unless your mortgage rates drop to where they were before, so 3% or lower, or some other variables must come into play, such as you must have more foreclosures. Well, what causes foreclosures? Unemployment, people unable to afford their homes under the current payments, so they have to be, you know, financially strained. And we'll talk about that possibly being one of the answers here. It may not happen anytime soon, but this could be what happens down the road to free up this market. Right here, I have the percentage of total outstanding credit card balances at least 30 days overdue. And this goes all the way back to 2004. As you can see, with the low rates, typically people were able to continue to borrow, use their credit cards, and not have any issues. But since the beginning of 2022, we've seen a very steep increase. And this, if it were to continue, could put a big strain on individuals' ability to pay their mortgages, thus potentially leading to foreclosures. That is my next point. This article here sort of touches upon some of these key points. Increased housing inventory. The new construction is being delivered to the market on a consistent basis, pumping up the inventory while demand has taken a deep decline because of high interest rates. We mentioned that previously. It's worth noting that the rise in foreclosures could lead to an increased influx of distressed properties onto the market, which would create a buyer's market with opportunities for those who are looking to invest in real estate. This could result in a decrease in prices or rental costs over time and could provide a great opportunity for investors or people looking to purchase a home. We have sellers married to their current low interest rates who are afraid to make a move and give these up for rates that are almost double. Our inventory problems would be alleviated even more if these sellers would put their homes on the market. That hits home exactly what I'm thinking. You know, this could be a great opportunity down the road, but in order for this supply to be freed up, that means a lot of people are running into serious financial issues. And we hope that that's not the case. Hopefully there's another solution out there that is better for all parties and we could find a natural market equilibrium. I don't know if that's going to happen, but I figured I would at least share this information with you to give you my thoughts about why I think this housing market is in a bad position at the moment with very little room to move, not because of natural market movement, but because of the interest rates impacting and freezing up pretty much the entire system. This happens in credit markets. Rates climb, the availability of credit drops, and you see ultimately less activity in the marketplace, and that's not good for anyone. I'm going to hit that home with this final point here before I let you go. This is also from the St. Louis Fed's website, and this is the personal savings rate. We're already potentially seeing some signs of people struggling. We don't know if this will translate into them not being able to pay their mortgages or home bills, but as you can see, the personal savings rate, although it was sort of peaked here due to the economic stimulus during the pandemic, right now, it's at a relative low when you look back across the decades. So we haven't seen a savings rate this low in a long time. This, compounded with the credit card delinquency rate, you know, moving up so quickly, really causes some concern. Now, that was all I had for you today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you had some thoughts of your own, please leave them in the comment section below. I would love to hear from you. If you enjoyed the video, I certainly encourage you to hit the like button. And please, hit the subscribe button if you wish to follow along for future videos in which I provide similar research like this about what I'm seeing in the economy and ways to help you potentially prepare yourself for things to come. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Have a great evening.